Merin loved the sea. She loved the sound of the waves calling to her through her window. She dreamt every night of the mysteries that lay beneath. Her father was a fisherman. Each day he went out to sea, and each night Merin waited at the rocky cliff edge, holding up a candle to guide him safely home. The two of them were poor. Their roof was leaky, and they sometimes went hungry. But as long as they had each other, Merin knew they would be okay. At night, her father sang her songs about his great adventures. He sang of giant leviathan serpents, haunted caves, and a lost city of gold beneath the sea. Merin knew the stories weren't real, but she loved to listen to them. She drifted off to sleep, imagining the wonders of the world below. And her life continued that way, simply and happily. Until one night, her father didn't return. Merin held up her candle at the cliff's edge all through the night, staring out at the empty sea. She shivered in the cold wind as she watched for him all the next day. Her eyes welled with tears as night fell again and there was still no sign of her father. At last, she collapsed into sleep. In her dreams, she saw him, trapped deep beneath the sea, calling to her for help. She awoke with a jolt. A desperate and dangerous plan was already forming in her head. She took scraps of metal and wood her father had caught in his nets and pieced them together. She hammered and bolted, she measured and sawed. And before the sun had set, she had built a tiny, rickety submarine. With trembling hands, she squeezed inside and dove down beneath the waves to search for her father. Beneath the waves shimmered with mystery. Glowkelp bulbs lit up around her as she passed by. Merin spotted some odd-looking old coins. Maybe her father would know where they were from. Flickered and danced on the seafloor, like an underwater fire. Her father once told her about a mysterious, living energy called Tyne. Could that have been a Tyne wellspring? A seahorse, made of clockwork gears, darted out of the way as Merin approached. She wondered who could have built such a curious creature. Approached a glowing scrap of metal and pulled it inside. It was claw-shaped and had a strong magnetic pull. She took out her tools and attached it to a firing mechanism on her steering column. Spotted shock nettles ahead of her. She had to be cautious, as the hostile creatures would attack her on sight. Guardian blocked Meryn's path. She knew it all too well from her father's stories, and she knew it must never be woken. According to her father, the Guardians had been built by ancient undersea explorers called the Fomori. Meryn always thought the Fomori were a myth. Now she wondered if her father's other stories might be true. The twisted forms of sunken ships stretched out in the distance. Was her father's boat somewhere among them? Statue reminded her of her father's lullabies about the brave and beautiful Meryn. Thank you. unexplored, she sketched the terrain on a sheet of cartography paper. Her father had taught her that those who make maps are never lost. A huge hermit crab watched Merrin from a rocky ledge. On his back, he carried a vast array of odd-looking treasures. The crab seemed to like shiny objects. Maybe he would be willing to make a trade. Amidst the wreckage of an old Fomori vessel lay an undamaged propulsion device. Merrin bolted it onto the back of her submarine, eager to test out its effects on her lightweight craft. were notoriously picky eaters. Each one seemed to prefer a different kind of treat. She bought from the hermit crab, Merin took out her tools and made a quick modification to her magnetic claw. Songs. These were the lost ruins of the Merrows. Blocked Merin's path. Although the creatures could be deadly to the touch, they were very shy and even avoided each other's light. Through the windows of the houses, wondering if a Merrow girl once lived there, and if her father had sung her lullabies about the world above. Thank you. discovered two glowing lights amidst the scraps of an old Fomori machine. She attached them to the front of the submarine's hull, hoping they would help guide her on her journey. Color darted through the shadows. Was that a Merrow maiden swimming through the ruins? Meryn tried to speak to her, but the Merrow raced away. The razor-quilled pufferfish was not a direct threat, but it steadfastly refused to move out of the way. Swirl in the water tugged at Meryn's sob. Was this a Tyne vortex? Where might it lead? At last, the Merrow Maiden stopped. Meryn called to her. Please wait. I'm only trying to find my father. The Merrow looked at her for a long moment, then stirred the water with her hands, forming a ghostly image. It was the sunken ship graveyard known as Skeleton Reef. Could her father be trapped there? The Merrow pointed the way to go, and Meryn thanked her. Before she turned to go, Meryn asked the Merrow her name.
Call me Kara, she said. Another girl once called me that, years ago. She said it means friend.
Thank you.
An elaborate system of traps and defenses had been built within the caves, and Merrin would soon discover why such measures had been necessary.
Thank you.
Into the bottom of the house, but the submarine was too big to fit through. Once been a flourishing city. What had happened here? Where were all the Merrows now? Cyclops turret scanned the quiet waters of the ruins, a solemn reminder of an ancient conflict. Merrin had discovered an old diving suit. She put it on, and in a pocket of the suit she found a striped seashell tied to a string. It looked just like the one her father kept above the fireplace. She tied the string around her neck, hoping the shell would bring her luck. Merrin held her breath and dove out through the submarine's hatch. She noticed bubbles coming out of the shell around her neck. Putting it to her mouth, she gently breathed in and felt the air fill her cheeks. Were these the same shells that were once used by ancient explorers?